Back with me now, attorney Barbara Smith and former assistant director to the FBI, Bill Gavin. Bill, Barbara, I want to ask you both this question. Is there any reason in the world, I know everyone reflexively wants to do this, you know, whether it's the Republican or the Democrat in the White House, I just can't imagine why any president would go to a special counsel irrespective of the demands from the opposing party. Barbara, can you think of any reason?
My reflexive answer would be that whether the president is a Democrat or a Republican, they should not do that, precisely because the Constitution is set up to give the president and the president alone all executive power in Article 2. And if you have a, quote, independent special prosecutor who's charged with exercising executive power but isn't accountable to the president, that strikes me as just fundamentally unconstitutional. And in fact, that's one of Justice Scalia's most famous dissents is a case that holds precisely, he says precisely that in his dissent. So I would reflexively say that that's a bad idea.
I like your idea of reflexive. If the country were as reflexive as you are, we'd be well thought out. Bill, your thoughts?
I have to agree with Barbara. I think it's a very bad idea to have a special prosecutor in a case like this. You have to rely on the integrity of the investigative institution that's conducting the probe. And having somebody that usurps the constitutional powers of the president makes as much sense to me as some of Chuck Schumer's ramblings.
I want to, if I may, touch on a couple of other things, and that is the director of the National Security Agency, NSA, Admiral Mike Rogers, testifying, saying that he has doubts that there is any collusion between the Trump administration and the Russians, and that the Russian hackers really wanted him to win. Yet that is precisely the opposite of what people were suggesting from the intelligence community. He said that at best the agency, the NSA, would have had only moderate confidence that Russians wanted him. It's interesting to see the man who's in charge talk about the ambiguity and the difficulty of coming up with an assessment as the partisans seek precisely that when they're testifying on Capitol Hill. Barbara, first you.
I think you're right, Lou, that it's a really tough question. It's very politically sensitive, and I think it's made more so by the fact that the public really never can know all of the facts, given that many of them are and should be classified. And I think that that just underscores the importance of President Trump nominating a replacement for Jim Comey that's seen as a straight shooter and fair and ethical, so that whatever the result of the ongoing investigations, the public has confidence that those results were reached fairly.
And what do you think, Bill?
I think where he sits, Lou, he has a set of earbuffs on and headphones and hears things that you and I don't hear and probably never will hear. So it's going to shade what his opinion is of what's happened versus what the perception of what happened really is.
And we hear Yates and Clapper testifying, both of them saying they never leaked information, but we can't hear or see those things that they have on their headphones that you referred to, Bill. She said nothing new, as the president said on a tweet. Clapper really offered nothing new. He reiterated that there is no evidence of collusion between Russia and Trump. Is it reasonable for us to assume that at some point we're going to have a definitive answer, or is it more likely we should assume that this is just going to at some point fritter away and dissipate into the ether, and that will be the end of the investigation? Bill?
I think, Lou, that you probably hit the nail on the head, that there might be some definitive information come out in the future, but I think there's a lot of hope that it will just disappear into the ether. And that, hopefully it doesn't, but it may very well do that.
And Barbara, very quickly, again, we're finding out as a result, Circa News is reporting, talking about 30,000 requests for information on American citizens who'd been surveilled. We know that 5,300 resulted in the unmasking of those folks who were then shared, their identities shared across the government. This is not what was contemplated by the authors of the legislation. And it is certainly not the deal that we thought we had made with our intelligence agencies, and particularly with the Obama administration, which clearly increased its unmasking from hundreds to thousands by the time they left office.
And it is, I think, at the end of the day, a political issue. And if Congress were interested in solving some of those problems with the legislation, then I would hope that it would weigh in and do so and find a compromise with the president and the executive branch that works for both of the political branches.
Bill?
I agree. I think it's a very difficult set of circumstances right now. 30,000, Lou, is just way out of line. And nobody should know. All of that information should never be released. And hopefully, out of this whole thing, out of this investigation, somebody finally goes to jail.
Wouldn't that be a thought? Bill Gavin,
wouldn't that be original?
Accountability in Washington, and particularly in our intelligence community. Barbara Smith, Bill Gavin, thank you both for being with us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lou. A pleasure.
Thank you. Up next, Senior Justice Department.